This camp is the Science U Kinesiology Camp. The purpose is to provide the campers with an opportunity to see what the study of human movement looks like.
The camp is subtitled The Limits of Human Performance. We've really explored the maximal aerobic capacity in this room. We are also going to explore anaerobic capacities. Aerobic capacity helps you perform long duration activities. Anaerobic activity is more for sprinting, so we're looking at both of those aspects. We taught the students how to measure blood pressure. It's an important measure of what we call hemodynamics, or how the heart is operating and how blood is circulating through the body. A stethoscope is used to auscultate blood pressures, and we listen in for carotid cough sounds in the antecubital space. We use a sphygmomanometer, which is a fancy way of saying a blood pressure cuff, to measure the pressures that are occurring with the changes in the systole and diastole. And that is gonna correspond with the systolic blood pressure and diastolic blood pressure. Systolic and diastolic are the two numbers in your blood pressure reading. Systolic value is the highest pressure that you're going to experience. The diastolic is the lowest pressure. So the systolic pressure is when the heart contracts, and the diastolic is when the heart relaxes. In order to gauge how the subject is before they exercise, we need to know where their starting point is. And so we do resting blood pressure values in the position they're going to exercise in. In case something bad happens, the subject would end up laying on the ground. And so we want to know what their blood pressure is in that position before they begin exercise.
Hers was right around 112 over 75, which is good.
We had the subjects do it while they were sitting, just as a way to practice. If they were going to do a bike test, we'd have them do a seated blood pressure at rest.
The systems that we went over with the campers were the respiratory, which includes the lungs, the trachea, the bronchioles, the nose, the nasal cavity. In this camp, we are using our cardiovascular system a lot. So we looked at the heart and looking at the veins and arteries. We also went over the integumentary system, which is the skin, the musculoskeletal system, how it supports the human body as the skeleton does, and how the muscles then are like the pulleys that will generate the motion to create those actions. Finally, we took a little look at the nervous system, which was the human brain. They did what's called goniometry. It's a tool that allows us to measure range of motion through whatever angle that we're looking at.
So now when I flex him the whole way up, he gets to 140. So if I minus that 8 degrees, how much does he actually have? 132, 132 degrees of flexion.
I tried to give them as much background information as I could so that when they went into the cadaver lab, they could take a better appreciation of the different structures on picture and how they varied when you actually see them in the cadavers themselves.
Lungs, liver, spleen.
So it's like right there,
protected by your ribs.
Yep, okay. Still protected by your ribs.
The male cadaver has an illness, and his spleen compared to the female cadaver was probably 4 or 5 times the size. The female cadavers had a total knee replacement, which is basically taking a piece of the femur off, the tibia off, and inserting a metal and plastic device inside the knee. I think the kids loved it. It's not every day that 13, 14, 15, 16 year old gets the opportunity to hold a human heart, human brain. I saw a lot of kids asking questions. That sense of wonder, trying to figure out what things were, asking what this organ was.
It needs to do so much work all the time.
They've been predicting maximal heart rates. They've been measuring their actual max heart rates. We taught them about their age predicted max heart rate. There's a lot of different prediction equations. The most commonly used one is 220 minus your age, and there's a lot of variability with that. One of them is, did they come within about 10 beats per minute of that age predicted max heart rate? The Bruce protocol is the most commonly used exercise testing protocol in the country, and it is a graded exercise test. There's multiple 3-minute stages where every 3 minutes the speed and the grade increase, so the intensity gets harder. The student will eventually reach a point where they cannot handle the workload. At that maximal intensity is usually when we're going to find their maximal oxygen consumption, their VO2 max value.
We got a high heart rate of about
200 beats per minute, which is about 5 under his maximum heart rate. And we got like a blood pressure of about 145 over 70 for his max. The normal, like whenever you're resting, is 120 over 80. So he's like 24 over, and then he went from 80 to 70. So he's just like really getting exercise and like moving a lot.
The masks are a Hans Rudolph one-way valve. They're able to breathe in through one side of the mask, and they exhale, and it's gonna close this valve so that the air is gonna be forced out through the tube and then over to the machines. We're able to measure the amount of oxygen that was in the expired air. They compare that to the amount of oxygen that was in the ambient air, and they can calculate how much oxygen was consumed.
We did what's called a one rep max testing. We did it both for the lower extremity and the upper extremity. The first one was a bench press. So the females had a 35 pound weight, the males had an 80 pound weight on the bar, and then they do till exhaustion to a metronome of 60 beats per minute.
3, okay. 6,
there we go.
Yeah. Most of the kids got to their one rep max, and actually some exceeded that.
Did you go?
Go, 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 push, hey.
7, okay, good job.
We did the exact same thing where we had them do a leg press, so that gave them the opportunity to see what their one rep max leg press was as well.
You got a 2.2, which puts you in the excellent category.
Okay.
So that's pretty good.
I think that might be your max.
The hand grip test is a combined right and left hand grip strength. It's a very simple tool to assess muscle strength.
Your war face. That was better. That's a 25.
We also got them to experience some of the other weights in the gym.
The lab-based testing that we've been doing so far requires all of this fancy equipment. You have treadmills, you've got the VO2 machines. When we do the Queens College step test, instead of using $28,000 worth of equipment, we use $30 worth of aerobic steps. Queens College step test, it's a 16.25 inch high depth test. We set a metronome at either 88 beats per minute or 96 beats per minute for a rate of 22 steps per minute or 24 steps per minute for females and males respectively. For 3 minutes, they step up according to the cadence set by the metronome. On the beep, up, up, down, down, up, up, down, down. After 3 minutes, they take their heart rate for 15 seconds. You plug that heart rate value into a prediction equation. It gives them an estimate of their VO2 max as well.
Up,
down. The Rockport walk test is the same. All you need is a track of a known distance. You can have everyone walk at their own self-selected pace. And there's a prediction equation that you can estimate VO2 max based on the subject's heart rate and time it takes them to walk a mile.
On your mark, get set, get ready. I didn't get back here. I didn't say go. Get back here. Go. Multiply that by 4, that's your heart rate.
Okay. Make sure the foot. Practicing taping ankles.
So you're making this anchor again here.
Oh.
Okay, so that's a C strip.
Oh.
Do it again, like figure it out. Yeah.
It's really tight, but it helps to keep your foot from like bending and flexing, supporting the ankle more.
So you're coming down, and then out the front. And it just comes off.
Perfect. I think it sprained my ankle.
Okay, ready?
1, 2, 3.
Ankle taping!
Testing our balance on foam pads for a baseline test to compare whenever we have concussions.
Then we want to make sure that her ear holes line up with the ear holes of the helmet, so I shouldn't be able to do any of this. Come across her shoulder, right like this, coming around, coming back up, and now we're back on top of her shoulder. Does it feel like it's holding you down a little bit?
Right.
Okay, and we're gonna come up around, make a knot in the back. So that is a sling and swap. So they can rest their hands. Somebody ran into it. She was playing football. She's the starting linebacker for Penn State. This is called a vacuum splint. Stay here. So this takes air out at this spot. This puts air back in at this spot.
Kids this age, they're getting into that time point in their lives where they can choose to be couch potatoes or they can choose to be active. And those people that are active usually have better values compared to those people who are not active.
Not a lot of people know what kinesiology is. And for kids this age to be exposed to it, to be able to go back to their hometowns, to their schools, and talk to their friends about this awesome camp, it might inspire others to want to get a job in kinesiology.
There's a clear separation between those people that are fitter versus those people who are less fit in terms of those same kind of health concerns. So it's a very important time in their lives where we introduce them to physical activity, get them active, and then hopefully they stick with it through their college and into their adult years.